think you have heard on several occasions this incident of our Lord Jesus Christ coming to some place over against Galilee where possessed men lived. Some were so possessed that they ran around naked and lived in tombs. Today, probably, psychologists would say that post-traumatic stress disorder or something and give them pills. However, it's quite plain that these people were indeed possessed. For what reason, we do not know. Well, certainly not from the gospel do we know. Nevertheless, this is where they abode. And in other gospels relating to this, some of them were self-harming themselves, cutting themselves and whatever. Does that sound familiar about the things that go on today? The demons understood that a righteous person had come to visit them, and they said, "Jesus, Son of the Most High, I entreat thee, do not begin to torment me." This one was speaking to one of them. They understood that their end is one of torment, and they're doing their best to put off that particular day, which is getting closer and closer to them, where the demons will indeed be put in their right place where they belong, where they have chosen to belong. The Lord gave them a consolation and allowed them to take possession of a herd of swine, because by law it was not right that the people who lived there should raise swine, pigs, which were forbidden from being eaten, etc. And to this day, that law still exists with the Hebrews and the ones that follow the Talmud. Never being able to do anything life-giving, the demons immediately took possession of the swine and ran them down into the lake where they drowned. Can you imagine such a sight happening? What an incredible, an unbelievable thing that would be. When I read it to you, when you read it to yourself, you say, "I have." In reality, if you witness something like that, what a great thing that would be. The man was so overjoyed for being released of these demons that he wanted to stay with the Lord. But the Lord gave him the command, which was the command that he gave to all as the last one. "Return to thy house, go on relating how much God did for thee." And he departed proclaiming throughout the whole city how much Jesus did for him. In other words, go and do some missionary work about this. Bring these people to the knowledge of the truth. Turn them away from raising swine and doing all sorts of horrid things which are not mentioned here. But to become possessed in general means that the people did indeed do horrid things, because a person who did righteous things and at least tried to stay on the right path would not get possessed. He would not open himself up to possession by the demons. I think you've seen that movie that recently came out some years ago called Ostrov, and how a young girl, young lady, is also possessed, and hence she could not be cured by doctors or psychologists or anything like that, but goes to the island and talks to the humble monk there that has been spending his whole life repenting, shoveling coal and bringing it to heat the whole area, because it exists in an Antarctic environment and gets extremely cold in winter. When you read something for the benefit of your soul, this is, we're talking here about orthodox materials or anything like that, or write something, or even talk about something, somewhere in there, there has to be repentance. Because if that's not there, then in fact, no matter how theologically good or whatever it might sound, it's pretty much worthless. Pretty much worthless. Some people who have done great sins and have come and repented in church, sort of very quickly pick up and continue in that way. Others, it takes longer. Weeks, months, maybe even years. Because they consider themselves so unworthy that holy things to them are still, I'd say, use the word frightful. Of course, if a person is repenting in a situation like that, they need to be under the eye of somebody who can guide them. Because you can't just say, I'm repenting and give up all things, don't go to church, don't do this, don't do that. I'm in a state of repentance, and until I feel right, I'm going to do it. That's not the way it works. It has to be done with the guidance of a God-bearing father or mother. Our Lord Jesus Christ accepts our repentance straight away. You don't have to wait. Even before you come and repent, he already knows what it is. And you needn't tempt the priest with details like some do. Some of the details I've heard so stick in your mind that you wish you never heard them before. They're so horrible. But be aware because some of you do write material for others to read and for their edification. Make sure that it is on the missionary aspects, and that repentance is the backbone of all those sorts of things. Otherwise, orthodoxy looks like just another religion which has fancy vestments and icons and all this, and it's a tradition of the Slavs. And you know what? The minute you put in there something good and strong about repentance, even in a kind way, many people turn away from it. They consider that it's not worth their while. Hence, they have chosen their path, and they might be so-called orthodox. And that repentance has to go with us for the rest of our life. We have to think like the man on Ostrov who carried that coal backwards and forwards and never considered himself anything special at all. At all. Such a state only comes from long and great prayer and obedience. Saint Mary of Egypt is another example of one like that, who, under the guidance of Mother of God, did go out into the desert and allowed herself to sort of suffer that repentance out of herself. All those passionate desires which can drive a person crazy. All the remembrances of the sins that were committed and the people that were hurt, perhaps even killed along the way on account of your actions. When that all becomes like part of you in a state of repentance, then you realize what repentance really is. Then you realize what it really is. It's not just coming here to the priest, you know, say, do you repent? I repent, okay. It involves suffering, because you have caused suffering to yourself, probably to others, and that has to be sort of purged out of you. Even though God forgives you, the results of that continue. May the Lord help us to recognize this aspect of repentance in the orthodox world that we come across in books, amongst people, and amongst others. Lately there was a group that exhibited themselves saying that they speak to Christ and all this and all that, and they walk around and make sand in their hands. And saw this exactly 10 years ago amongst the Tibetan Buddhists or something. They would walk around and make sand in their hands. And most of their disciples were Westerners. make some sand. What are you going to do then? You know? All these things are helps, assistances from the demons who want you to follow their way, not the way of Christ. And if you've gone deeply with them, the breaking loose is very hard. It's very hard. This person here that met Christ, he couldn't break through. It had to be Christ that came and actually got him out of that situation. Firstly, let us hope, pray that we never get into a situation where we hurt others knowingly or unknowingly or accidentally or any other way, and that nobody does us harm knowingly or unknowingly or accidentally. And if anything of that happens, we have a path by which all of those things are put right insofar as our souls are concerned. We preserve that treasure, because the treasure, as I've been telling the acolytes of the altar, that there is nothing greater than that on earth. There's nothing greater than that. How rich you are, how poor you are, how much power you hold in the earth.